What I ended up making sounds very different from things I make outside of group collaboration, and maybe that reflects what happens when people come together around one idea. Like, everything changes.
It's not the private space of the house, it's not the public space of the street, but it's really like that in-between space that where everything would happen, every sign of identity, every sign of belief, of politics. We thought like this would be the terrain where a discussion would happen.
For LA Forum's 2020 summer exhibition, we commissioned 20 new texts and visual works by 20 participants. We wanted to go big in the new decade and look forward. Nina and I decided that instead of issuing a call for proposals for this year's summer exhibition, we didn't want to write a typical call for ideas or a curatorial call. We wanted to upend how we formulate an architecture exhibition. We were more concerned about what we might be missing if we took the conventional track. So we started with writers. Writers are excellent communicators and translators of the city. So the writers, in a sense, then wrote the prompt for the visual works based on their future vision for LA in the 20s.
The origins of the call and response as an instigator of expression are rooted in the traditions brought to America by Africans who were enslaved. And it became a diasporic ritual practiced in Black communities, Black churches, and on plantations as spiritual and work songs born out of struggle and oppression. And that evolved into gospel music, this kind of melodic, democratic response to the preacher in the church. So as a creative exercise towards freedom and recalling memory and fostering both a unified and distinct voices, call and response cultivates dialogue and encourages improvisation. When the call is a multidisciplinary catalyst, as it was with Everything Changes, it expands the spaces between the writer's words, and it invites a more individualized, innovative response from designers, while also unifying their attention to the text. The call's intention was to broaden and celebrate the unique and collective perspectives by the collaborators' imagined futures.
One writer was paired with one designer. We had five writers, five designers we began with, and Nina and I did those pairings. And then they, the writer and the designer, were asked each to bring in one plus one, a creative producer from any number of other fields. We ended up with a wide variety of participants from different backgrounds and 20 total. I think the call and response process, that it only gets better with a large group. I think being honest about the collective imagination of the city is important. And the honest truth is that there is not one version of LA. That was very important to me to try to capture in the exhibition.
This exhibition proposed an equal process in unlocking and expanding of the dialogue across the disciplines, across representation, across visions of Los Angeles in the 20s.
What I did for the Castle and the Trees piece, my intention was to make a soundscape or some sort of piece of music, give some sort of sonic illustration to the text that Lisa Teasley wrote, which was the prompt for my response as well as for the whole project. I used certain sounds to symbolize various aspects of the collaborative space, like the flow of creative energy that Lisa describes, the communication and interaction between people, the joy, the natural landscape around the space, and the various art practices and community organizing taking place. My intentions were to both theoretically fill the space, the imagined space that is the castle, resonate its walls and floors, as well as illustrate the energy, the creative activity that takes place within the space. So I started by recording a drone with an accordion that kind of represents that ever-present movement of creative energy. And then I just built on that with various percussion, wind, and string instruments that kind of represent the doing happening and the being happening in the space and the interactions and rhythms and relationships between the instruments are the conversation and collaboration in the castle. It was such an innovative exhibition idea. I feel like the way that we came together and created this installation was just really reflective of what the Castle in the Trees is all about.
By Multiples is a physical interpretation of Lisa Teasley's Castle in the Trees. It is an assemblage of systems and parts that was developed through a dynamic collaborative effort without a known outcome. The systems and parts interact with each other, with the elements and the context. And the effort was more about emulating the collaboration that happens in the castle than about making a castle per se. We were interested in creating a non-rigid, playful space. There's a hanging net by Alejandra Novello based on a 6x6 foot grid pattern. This net becomes the main organizing element as a metaphor for the interconnected intense system we live in. There are two carefully crafted cones from colorful weaved yarn by Luis Montoya. These pieces hang from the grid and move with the wind, projecting intricate shadows. They represent both the physical realm of the castle and the transient presence of the people that inside the castle create in a balancing act the schedules and opportunities. There's a tower made from stacked color cubes by Irving Alvarez that makes reference to the safety of a physical place. The inside of the cubes is lined with a reflective material. The reflections contrast the physical from the ethereal. Also, there are two amorphous pieces by Kanata Yamayoshi made from paper mache. These represent the need for a difference of opinion. All scales, shapes, and colors are represented, a metaphor for society. And finally, there's a veil that weaves through the hanging net to then land on the ground. Monica Lamelo's veil interacts with the elements, moving, reflecting, sounding. The veil stands in a fragile equilibrium as a temporary balance with a collapsing system that shows a glimpse of hope. The materiality of the veil is important. It's a technological advance, yet it is the first thing that immigrants are issued when taken into custody. In the exhibit, the veil no longer covers, suppresses, and imposes, but reflects, interacts, and unveils.
Regulatory Nonsense is a project that was kind of spawned out of frustration, I think, for the way that we currently regulate our built environment. I had this idea, you know, like, what if instead of kind of focusing on regulating things like height and setback, we got a bunch of poets together to sort of rewrite the planning regulations. As this project really developed, a lot of deep learning, sort of natural language processing bots began to kind of evolve. So I kind of thought, like, maybe the thing to do is actually to feed a bot a bunch of different kind of poetry, creative prose, and then see what happens if I ask it to kind of rewrite planning regulations. So what you get is like a really kind of strange mix of sort of sci-fi and nonsense and a lot of really odd suggestions for how we might regulate what we do in the built environment. The project for Everything Changes was really tailored towards the kind of legacy of kind of creative fiction and prose that has been written about Los Angeles over the years. I'm interested in it generating things that are unusual and unpredictable, and then using that, I guess, as a prompt to kind of think about what an alternative city might be.
The initial prompt that I received from Wendy, it was asking for consideration of Los Angeles in the decade to come. So I ended up writing a text called April 23, 2022. The idea is to approach the entire city and start to understand Los Angeles through patterns and start to compare what we see in one area of the region to another. There have been forces in the city of increasing affordability crisis for housing, increasing homelessness, increasing economic segregation in the city. So I chose two locations. One was a set of houses, a kind of a block of housing in the El Sereno area that in the first few weeks of the pandemic shutdown was reclaimed by a group of housing activists. And these are the houses that are famously known as the Caltrans houses, because they were the houses that were taken from families by eminent domain for the extension of the 710 freeway that never happened. For many years in Los Angeles, even as housing had become fraught here as affordability crises increased, there was 100 houses just sitting right there in a wonderful part of the city, totally empty. This group in El Sereno then reclaimed these houses, and people are still in residence there. They've taken this property back from the larger force that had repossessed it, kind of matching a refusal with a refusal. There's a refusal to admit that this was a wrong thing from Caltrans to do, to take all these homes away from people, and a refusal to continue to accept that they had done that and to let the status quo remain. And at the same time, I read an LA Magazine article about this building called 10,000 that's at the address of 10,000 Santa Monica Boulevard, kind of right at the line of Beverly Hills and Century City. The article was framing this place as representing so much local extremity, in that the rents were running from $10,000 to $65,000 a month. It was just so profoundly ridiculous, and it represented so much of another kind of refusal that I'd observed in the last 10 years, which was this refusal to really question the kind of new housing that we're making. So then to read about 10,000, it just then represented this whole other side, exact polar opposite of activists having to reclaim empty houses. I imagined that I would be with my class and we would start our day in El Sereno and understand this space and the understand the histories and needs that had led to this community reclaiming housing, and then going in the same day and going and seeing 10,000 and then just kind of trying to process that, you know, that polarity amongst ourselves in a discussion.
We were extremely stimulated by Terry's text because it was a story of how she came to know about LA and the Women's Center in downtown LA, and she moved to LA to be part of a queer community and to start to find her own community. And we could really relate to that when we arrived to LA and how our journey in discovering LA was. This is what we wanted to convey, a sense of belonging and a sense of community, hence the name of our piece, Belonging, to be longing to belong. Our way to review and to look at LA was to start by going around different neighborhoods, and we mainly gathered 28 different 3D scans from different houses from residential neighborhoods.
In this kind of case, since we took like the queer community because of the text and because of us, so it was kind of really interesting because there are a lot of stereotypes, and LA has a very typical, like, kind of flat typology of single-story houses. So both of these kind of, like, play well together. We usually try to kind of express those social cues by, like, visually. What we were mainly trying to do is basically take porches, because it seemed like the porches are very expressive in LA. People have a lot of themselves in the porches of their houses. I think that's super interesting, just to kind of understand a person through like just a porch.
We were really looking at reinforcing, so using stereotype to empower the vision of what queer community is in LA and how you can identify it if you already belong to that community. The piece goes as a road diary, so you're driving in a car because this is what you do in LA, and you're driving through neighborhoods, and it's 28 different houses from everywhere scattered around LA, but all put on the same street. It's being unified through their diversity and their individualized and specific aspect of their own queer culture. In Belonging, the person driving through LA for the first time is the same story as Terry, is the same story as our arrival to LA. So it's a woman, her name is Amal, and Amal in Arabic translates to hope. We thought it was really, I think, significant to mention her name. And Amal drives through LA and discovers LA looking for signs of community, looking that she is going to find a queer neighborhood or she's gonna belong because she sees something that belongs to her Middle Eastern or Arabic culture.
Just the fact that Amal can see herself in a different country and with diverse kind of neighborhoods, but she could still kind of see signs of herself, I think is really interesting to just say we have similarities, but we're also very different.
This is really like the intricacy and the complexity, the multiplicity of the various narratives that come together, and they don't form a unity, but they actually overlap in a creative way.
I'm still ruminating on the works and all the issues that they touched upon. They exposed the socioeconomic and environmental issues that continue to plague and question the city. The concept began itself as a sort of disruption of conventional curation. These unforeseen outcomes, they were revelations, and revelations that constantly inspired us and challenged in a positive way the curation.